Welcome back to BOGObiology. Today we're going to expand on the topic of Mendelian genetics by discussing something called the DiHybrid Cross. If you missed out on the original video introducing the idea of Mendelian genetics, definitely check it out here. As I pointed out in the original video, it's rare to have one gene to one trait matchups. Most traits are determined by the interaction of several genes, and there are also genes that control multiple traits. It's important to keep this in mind as we go through the video. When organisms reproduce, their haploid gametes, i.e. their sex cells, combine to form diploid offspring. Since the gametes carry the genetic information in their DNA, the offspring will inherit one set of genes from each parent. The resulting zygote is now diploid and has genetic information from both parents. If you look closely, you'll notice that the mother and father each contributed a slightly different allele for the same trait on this blue chromosome. We'll see why this is important in just a minute. To keep things simple, let's begin by breeding some fake organisms that I call dots. Unlike most creatures in the real world, dots are the ideal species for us to study because their traits always follow the rules of Mendelian genetics perfectly. Among other characteristics, dots can be either large or small in size and have either a fluffy or a smooth coat. Large and fluffy are the two dominant traits. For our first experiment, we're going to breed two dots together. The first one is going to be homozygous for largeness and fluffiness, and the second dot is going to be homozygous for smallness and smoothness. This first dot is going to produce sex cells that have an allele for large size and an allele for a fluffy coat. The second dot will produce sex cells that have alleles for small size and a smooth coat. The first dot can't contribute a small or a smooth allele, and the second dot cannot contribute a large or a fluffy allele. We could probably work out the genotypes that their offspring could have, but let's do a Punnet square anyway. On the sides of the Punnet square, we're going to put down the possible combinations of alleles that each one of the organisms could contribute. The first dot has only large and fluffy alleles to contribute, so that's all we're going to put down. The second dot has only small and smooth alleles to contribute. Because one dot can only contribute a large L and a large F, and the other dot can only contribute a small L and a small F, every one of their offspring is going to have the genotype big L, little L, big F, little F. It's going to be heterozygous for both traits. Despite having the large and fluffy phenotype, every one of the offspring is going to be heterozygous for size and for fluffiness. In short, they're all going to be dihybrids. Now let's try breeding two identically dihybrid organisms together and see what happens. Because these organisms have both the large L and the small L alleles, their sex cells could contain either the large allele or the small allele. Similarly, they could contain the fluffy large F allele or the smooth small F allele. This makes for four possible combinations of alleles that could be in their gametes. In short, every possible combination of upper and lowercase L and upper and lowercase F. 1, 2, 3, and 4. We don't know which set will be passed on when they reproduce, but we can work out the probability. For this Punnett square, we're going to list all the possible combinations of alleles in the sperm cells on one side, and on the other side we'll list all the possible combinations of alleles in the egg cells. This first organism could have any one of these genotypes in its sex cells. The second organism is the same. Now we can pretty easily work out all the possible combinations of alleles that the offspring could receive. See if you can work out all 16 squares. Okay, so here are the potential genotypes for the offspring. Notice that some of the genotypes are much more common than others. If we color code them, we can see there are 9 possible combinations of alleles. The most common genotype is this one right here, which is another dihybrid. Now let's check out their phenotypes. It's pretty easy to see that the most common phenotype is for the offspring to be large and fluffy. In fact, the offspring are created in a ratio of 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. Again, remember that the probabilities start over every time reproduction occurs. Having one large and fluffy offspring does not increase the chances of having a small and smooth offspring later on. So to test out how comfortable you are with the material, see if you can work out the genotype and phenotype possibilities for these two organisms' offspring. If you're stuck on how to get started, remember to put all of the possible combinations of alleles into this space right here. Here are all the possible combinations of alleles that each parent could contribute. Now we have all the possible genotypes for their offspring. Before you work out the phenotypes, see if you can take an educated guess as to the ratio of large to small and fluffy to smooth. Notice that we have a 50-50 split of large and small offspring, but that every single one of the offspring has the fluffy phenotype. Even though there are no smooth individuals in this generation, because some of the offspring are heterozygous for smoothness, they might be able to produce smooth offspring themselves. All right, that's pretty much it. If you found this video useful, I hope you'll consider subscribing to my channel and also checking out some of my other videos. I put a lot of time into creating them, and I'm always looking for new ideas for content that would be useful to you all. Thanks so much for watching, and please don't forget to subscribe.